All right, so without further ado, I would like to introduce to you your moderator for this afternoon, Fernando.
How you guys doing? Man, I'm excited to hear it. That welcome was nice. If that's how you welcome me, I'm just a moderator. I'm excited to see how you welcome our guests. Welcome to Beyond Mechanics, Designing a More Powerful Game. We have a wonderful trio of talent to share their thoughts and ideas with you, and I want to explain to you how this is going to work. I have a bunch of questions, so I'm pretty much ready to go. But after I give you a few softballs to get warmed up, I want you guys to start thinking about questions that you might have on your mind. And at some point, somebody's going to be running around with a microphone, so you just let them know that you have a question, and I don't mind stopping what we're doing to get one of your questions answered, because we're here for you. But don't worry, I got plenty of questions of my own, so I can keep this thing going for quite a while. Everybody ready?
Yeah.
All right. In that case, please welcome to the stage, Jameson, Durall. Also, Elbert, Perez. Last and certainly least, Grant Shonkwiler. That last part was a joke.
Well done.
Hey, which one's this one?
All right, so to start things off a little bit easy, I want to talk about what your favorite game has been over the last 2 to 5 years. Okay, let's start things off with Grant. Just favorite game, and why would that be like one of your favorite games that you've played in the last 2 to 5 years?
2 to 5 years. Oh, my mic get turned off? It's still on.
Is it on? Oh, mine's on. Oh, there we go.
Hello.
Yep, you're on.
Oh, sorry about that. So let's see. Probably last 5 years. Did FTL come out in the last five years? Yeah, I would say FTL. That's the game that I constantly am returning to because the mechanics are just so solid. And they keep updating it. They keep making it more interesting, adding plus-plus game and stuff like that. I really love like the Assassin's Creed games and stuff, but I usually burn through those one at a time. But FTL, I continually come back to play, get frustrated because it's super hard. But yeah, I would say FTL, just great game.
Awesome. Albert?
My favorite is StarCraft II because, you know, I grew up playing StarCraft, and StarCraft II is a sequel, and StarCraft is more older than StarCraft II, past 2 to 5 years, so I can't say that.
I saw a number of fist bumps, so there's a large number of people here who agree with that decision.
All right.
And Jameson?
I guess the thing that comes to mind most was the second Arkham Batman game. Like
that was a good one.
Really good experience. Had a good time with that.
Awesome. So now, before you start working on a task, let's say you're working on a project, you start working on a task. Do you happen to find that you look for software that already has implemented that task previously? Let's start with Jameson.
You mean like on a tool side, like
in anything, like if you're working on a tool set. You know, do you look at other tools to see how they've accomplished similar tasks? Or do you prefer, whenever I find, you're implementing something, there's an adventure, there's a sense of adventure to kind of discovering your own implementation, your own solutions. But do you try to kind of just stick with that, just for the sense of adventure, figure it out on your own? Or do you look at other solutions, and why would you do that?
Sure. I've always, everywhere that I've worked, we've had proprietary tool sets. So we're always basically building our own stuff in order to tailor it to the games that we make. But as a part of that, we also have a lot of familiarity with other tools that are out there. So if we see something that we like, we'll be like, hey, I like how they're doing this. Is there a way we could integrate this into what we're doing? Or even on top of that, we're always looking for ways to say, hey, we here's how we do this thing. Can we do it better? Anytime you can do something better, more efficiently, that's going to be a good thing for your productivity. So I think I do not think this is an industry where you would all kind of stay set in your ways. I think you really can't do that, and because everything is moving faster and getting easier, and we want to stay ahead of that curve.
All right. Yeah. Grant, did you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I think constantly both in game design and in building a tool set, you look at what other people are doing, but also as you're adding new people to your team, they're bringing the knowledge that they had working on either their proprietary tool set or maybe a different engine, and they talk about how they worked there, better workflows and stuff like that, and you work together to build something better. You know, there is, like you said, a sense of adventure of just trying to solve something new, but at the same time, everybody is on a time deadline, and you can only R&D for so long. At some point, it's easier to just look at what somebody did and then expand on that and do something better and do the research on the tail end.
Albert, I've got an easy one for you.
Sure.
What is your favorite interface in a video game, and why?
Oh man! Like in terms of like UI and
anything that you look at in a video game that you look at their interface and you say these people are doing it right and more people should be doing it like this.
Motion controls on VR. I mean, the games aren't out yet. It's kind of cheating because I see them all the time. Sorry, but just being able to like use your hand, reach out, touch and grab something is supernatural, and you don't need tutorials to tell people how to grab something, because you know they usually know how to grab a piece of bottle and throw it, and this is which what most people will do in any of these games is grab the first thing in heaven and throw it, and I love that because it's so natural.
Needless to say, you're ready for VR.
Yes.
I'll jab you a little bit on that one a little bit later on.
Okay.
all right. Now we're going to get into some of the more nitty-gritty questions. So 12, 13 years ago, we were dipping our toes into renderware. I don't know how many people remember renderware. And I remember 12, 13 years ago as a student myself, I remember people saying middleware. Middleware is the way to go. Middleware is the way we're going. And we've seen just this over the last decade or so, we've seen this incredible rise in the adoption of middleware tool sets, Unity, Unreal. We see Amazon dipping their toes into that space right now. So if more companies are adopting these, aren't there going to be fewer differentiators between companies if everybody's using the same tool sets or similar tool sets? Jameson, you want to start?
Yeah, I actually used renderware on the first Godfather game. We built that in there, and we used it on the Simpsons game as well. I never would classify Unreal as middleware. Like I mean, to me, that's a full production tool set and engine, right? Like, I mean, that's part of the root of what you're asking is like these powerful tools, you know, and how are people using that stuff? To me, I've never really considered a tool as a limiter, right? Like it's an enabler. So whenever we have this tool set, they're like in the case of Unreal, which I'm sure you can talk to even better than I can, but you know, it's they're constantly improving that tool set, right? And then even on the back end, you can take that and add the tools to it that you need. You know, you can, as you want to develop things, you kind of create that stuff and create what you need in order to make the game you want to make.
Sure. But wouldn't you say that companies, especially before and probably some even now, have like a tremendous sense of pride that they roll out their own tech, and they use that as a differentiator when competing for projects. So if everybody's using the same tool set, wouldn't you say that reduces the uniqueness of one company over another?
I would say that it doesn't necessarily limit the uniqueness. I think what it does is it actually opens up more ability to do interesting things, because you're not focused on graphics, you're not focused on tech. What you're focused on now is game development. You're focused on making actual interesting game mechanics, interesting stories, interesting experiences. And what you see, what you're actually seeing now is with games like Gone Home, Firewatch, Everybody's Gone to the Rapture, games like that that are more experiential, is that these people have experience with a known engine. They don't have to have a bunch of people on their team. There's 3, 4. I mean, FTL is an interesting example. That was 2 guys. You know, but you can have smaller teams making smaller, more intimate experiences. And the other thing is, it's easier to transfer onto projects, right? Because if you've worked in Unreal and you go somewhere and you work in Unreal there, you have that knowledge going in. You don't have to learn new proprietary software. I think the most differential thing that you see is graphics between different engines, and I think we're kind of getting to the uncanny valley in a lot of graphical sets, where you know, you look at a game like Star Wars Battlefront, or even Uncharted, games like that, the new Uncharted, they're hard to even tell that they are like a video game, right? They look like a CGI movie, you know, and course, when they're running in 30 frames per second, they look even more like a movie. But you know, I think it really it opens up the ability for smaller teams to make more interesting things because the you know the engines are so widely accepted now, and the knowledge is out there. And when you have literally hundreds of thousands of people using something, it just makes it better.
Have you ever been working on a project where you're using one of these engines and you found an engine-specific problem and you want to solve that engine-specific problem, but obviously you're not on the engine team. You know, there's an entire company devoted to that, and you're basically held ransom by these companies waiting for them to solve a problem that's kind of out of your hands. Have you been in that situation before, Elbert?
Oh, all the time.
So wouldn't you say that that's a potential negative of adopting these tool sets?
Yeah, but the thing is, though, I use Unity at work, but it's such a widely used engine that there's a lot of support, even if you don't get direct support from Unity. I mean, we have a good relationship with them, so we get a lot of support from them. But even just doing a Google search and like, hey, I have this problem, and then you can find it on Stack Overflow and all that stuff. So it's a blessing and a curse, but you can also, if you pay enough money, I think, through Unity, they'll give you access to source and you can fix it yourself. So, but with any familiarity with engine, you should know that what you should be able to do and not be able to do. Mm-hmm. But obviously, and you work around that, obviously. So,
Grant, you said something that for me was very revealing. You said that with the advent of these tools and the adoption of these tools and these tools becoming incredibly powerful, that smaller and smaller teams are able to accomplish more and more.
Yeah.
And so I'm wondering, in this space where now we're seeing a lot of visual scripting getting adopted in these tool sets. I'm wondering, do software engineers need to have some level of concern over their place on a game team?
No.
Or are we going to see in the future that more design-focused teams or tech design-focused teams are going to be the main contributors on projects, or do software engineers still have space?
I mean, I would say that all those small teams, probably both of the two people on FTL coded. Actually, I know for a fact both of them coded. Just having that experience level, I mean, currently, I'm working on a game in Unreal, and we have, I think, 11 programmers on a team of 50, and you have to have them there because you have to write blueprint functions. You can do just about everything in some way in blueprints, but sometimes it's just faster to do it in code. And then I think it's valuable that once you understand how to write code, you start to learn how to use a visual scripting language. It just makes it easier for everybody involved. Going back to your last question, I have to put a plug in. If you pay Unreal, you pay Epic $0, you get the source. So, but also I have the problem where I get blocked by the engine team, but I have feet, right? I get to just walk to the other side of the building and say, hey, can you guys help us out? But what's interesting is, when you open up the engine for free, you have thousands of people asking for support. Yeah. And so you kind of have to gauge the masses and see, okay, there's X number of people said that this is bad. We should go focus on that, right? And that's what's crazy about being an engine developer is that you have requests coming from everywhere, and you have probably hundreds of thousands of requests. But what we did was with opening up the sources that, if Elbert has a problem and he wants to solve it himself, he can solve it, and then he can commit the code, right, and he's solving the problem for us.
Right.
And we're kind of building the engine as a community, which is really cool.
Jameson, you're on the other side of this. You're working on proprietary tech. So if you run into an issue, it's very easy for you guys to just dive in and fix it. Do you feel like that gives you guys an advantage?
Yes. Yeah, I mean, definitely. Well, it's not always easy, but we definitely have the accessibility to do that. But at the same time, we're trying to develop tools that have things like visual scripting engines and things like that. And, part of it is, yes, we have the ability to kind of we evaluate, we build a tool that's good for what we want to do and the kind of games we want to make. We have that support on the back end immediately. If things are, a problem, we can get fixes that day. Absolutely. That's a huge benefit. But even speaking generally, having something like a visual scripting engine and things that allows more people to contribute, allows you to disperse the work more, right? And so you don't have to wait for X person to do this thing. If someone else can help with that, then that's something that they can take on, and you have more resources available to, you know, to get some things done.
But if all these tools are already, you know, adopting a lot of those aspects, why spend the resources? Because I imagine there's a lot of developers on that, you know, a lot of tools developers that you're putting on there. It's a lot of money that you're investing to develop your own proprietary tech. Why not, you know, especially if you can get some of these tool sets for reasonably cheap, why spend that kind of resources on proprietary tech?
I think a lot of times it's because you want to do something very specific that the tool sets that are available don't do well enough or well enough yet. Right, like, and because we actually evaluated other engines when we were going into development on the current project, mm-hmm. and we just didn't feel like the support and or the capability of what was out there was going to do what we wanted to do. Plus, quite honestly, people prefer to do their own thing if they can, right? Like, there's a little bit of an ego and that I can do it better mentality for right or wrong, and and you know that like that's pretty prevalent in our industry, I think.
It's especially prevalent in engine and rendering programmers.
Yes, absolutely.
Oh, man, it's the greatest.
Does anybody have any questions so far? Anything? Oh, we see. I see one up here.
I can't see anything.
Question in
That's okay.
Mic on. Question in the back.
Hi, my name's Wyatt Smith, and I am in the game design program. And my question is, do you feel that AAA studios are threatened at all by this technology coming out for free for indie developers?
Did you guys hear that okay?
Yeah, I don't think, no, I don't. Personally, I feel like there's varying scales of game development, right? Like, I feel like there is currently still a place for AAA development, right? Like, that's while that is true, I feel like the tools available are allowing smaller groups to make more impactful experiences, right? So at some point, maybe we'll get to the point where that becomes an issue. But right now, I think that there's, and for the foreseeable future, there's very different markets there.
Yeah, a lot of times people like to say that we're competing for the same time of a player, right? So AAA game is competing for the same time as an indie game. But I don't necessarily think that's true. Like, if I'm in the mood to play that Dragon Cancer, I'm definitely not in the mood to play, you know, some AAA first-person shooter. They're very different experiences. One is intimate and it's kind of crushing. The other one is just blatant fun. So I think if anything, coming from our side of it, of being on one of those, part of one of those bigger studios, is it's really inspiring because we're seeing people try new mechanics. Because when you're on a team of four, you can try new mechanics a lot easier than a team of 50 or 200. You can try weird things, and we get to see that, and we get to play that. And we're also seeing the medium change to reflect even more of film, right? So you're going to have your big summer blockbusters. Those are never going to go away. You're going to have your big games like Call of Duty and stuff like that. Those aren't going to go away anytime soon. But we're seeing more accessibility into indie games and higher quality indie games. I mean, people are finally making non-platformer games as indie games. I mean, like, I don't know about you all, but that's pretty awesome because yeah. I'm tired of playing platformer games with a new twist on Mario, you know? So
hey, man,
I think
hate.
If anything, it's just inspiring.
Don't hate.
What?
Don't
I'm
hate.
Not hating. It's just there's so it's what everybody does.
It's because they're
good. Fun. I mean, I love Braid. Braid's a great game, man.
Wow.
Be the Guy. That's a great game, too.
Sure.
It's a great question. Thank you. I did want to follow up on that, though. You know, so we're talking about there's always going to be a space for AAA, but we're seeing more and more AAA games that are just spending way too many resources. I mean, games are just getting so expensive to make, and you'll see a game that ends up selling a million copies, and it's seen as a complete disastrous failure. Mm. Isn't that a problem for companies that want to stay in the AAA space?
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah. You just summarized all. So,
budgets are going up. Team sizes are going up. Cost of video game to purchase is not going up. Right?
Like, hasn't gone up for
yeah.
a long time.
Yeah, and it's not going to.
Next
I mean,
generation will do 70.
Yeah. So it is a problem. So like the approach we are taking is to try and make tools. This is a big part of why we develop our own tools, is so that we can make things that allow us to do what we need to do as efficiently as possible. Mm-hmm. Right? Because we have 200 people, which is a lot for a studio, but we don't have the 1,200 that Ubisoft can throw at a project, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it takes us longer. We have to be smarter. We have to be as efficient as possible. And while we also try to be a place that allows us to iterate quickly and try things out and be able to see how it feels before we put a whole lot of time into an idea that might not be something that's in the end going to be worthwhile, we can do that quickly with these tools and make decisions quickly. We don't always do that, but we can.
What's really interesting is you're continuing to see some sort of desire to monetize on a game after it's been released, right? So mm-hmm. be that DLC, be that in-game purchases, or you know, and everybody's experimenting because everybody's trying to figure out as a gamer, you know, we're all gamers, what level of okayness do we have with paying $60 for a game and then paying $5 to unlock something in the game or something like that. So I think the business model is going to take a big shift. I think people are trying to figure out how to get the most amount of money out of a single buyer as possible. I mean, that's why I jokingly call it free to play and pay to play.
Yeah.
Because like a $60 game is you pay to play it, whereas free to play, you know, the potential is that the person's going to spend way more money on the game than $60, but you have a lot higher potential that not everybody's going to spend that money.
Right.
And as team sizes and stuff go up, we have to just continue to look into ways to be more efficient and also guarantee that what we're releasing is going to be successful, which is kind of terrifying from a AAA perspective. Yeah.
That's a great question that spawned a line of thinking over here. I have another question over here.
And we actually have two questions coming from us from the YouTube channel, so let's go ahead and address those.
All right, so our first question for our audience, for our online audience members, from Joseph Sheldon. He's asking, so what engines work for VR right now? We have a couple of the chat members who answered Unity or Unreal.
Both.
Are those possibilities?
Both.
Both of them, yes.
Wait, can I say both? He'll answer the question.
The answer is Unity and Unreal Engine, and you can make your own engine. Like especially for the Vive, it supports OpenVR, which is an OpenC API, which you can build custom engines around. And we've done it internally, and it's pretty cool.
Do you have a preference in an engine that you like to work in for VR?
So I'm a prototyper, so I prefer Unity. It, mm-hmm. There's a lot of VR plugins now.
You're getting a lot of shade thrown your way right now.
No, but granted, Unreal is pretty awesome because we do visit their offices in Bellevue, and they're super helpful for us. But it's just that it was just timing that Unity had their plugin ready, or Steam supported Unity earlier, but Unreal Engine is actually pretty much on par right now. It's just all my code is in Unity, and I'm using Unity.
It's on par.
On par.
He also said, granted.
He did.
That was great. Good job. Well done. All right.
And they have a second question, too.
We do. This is not posed to any particular panelists, but it's from Zachary Taylor in Game Design. He asks, what is the one thing you would say that you could have done to better prepare yourself for the industry?
Could have, as in coming out of school?
Or we did. I think it was did.
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 He is. He's asking, what could you have done?
Oh, could you? I? Okay.
Grant?
We know you could have done lots of things.
There's lots of things I could have done. Lots of things I could have done better. Wow. I think I didn't quite have the full understanding of the scope of different types of games. So I think everybody kind of comes here with the desire to go work on AAA. I was weird. I had the desire to work in casual games. And when I went to work on casual games, it was very similar to working at Full Sail, but it was also very different. And so I didn't quite have the full understanding of what the full scope of games meant from like a business perspective and things like that. So I very quickly had to learn, because I was working at a small studio, I very quickly had to learn, you know, business aspects and things like that. So I think what I could have done better is just been a little more broad in my education. So I always encourage people, especially in game development, to talk to other degree programs, because you're going to end up working with someone in each one of those creative departments. But I never talked to any of like the business people. So I think I would have done that, because that ended up being actually part of my job for a while.
For me, I think I got a little bit complacent when I got out. The reason being, like, I was able to secure a job before I graduated, and that made me kind of like, oh, I'm not as hungry anymore. I got a job now. I'll be fine. Which kind of like, I think I probably spent like a year or two not working on games because of that. But then I quickly found it back. I'm like, oh man, I should be going back into games. And, you know, I was working on software, which is totally legit if you're working in game development, you know, programming, all that stuff. It's just that final project like really made me feel satisfied in making a game, and I was like, oh, I'm going to try something else. But I quickly discovered, like, yeah, my passion really is in making interactive experiences in games. And yeah, don't let that fire burn out when you leave.
I think for me it was, when I went through the program, we only had developers that worked with us on our final projects and stuff. We didn't have any artists or anything like that. And I didn't understand what other people's roles on the projects were. And the thing that I quickly found was being able to talk intelligently to someone about how they create their art, or how I need to work with them to compromise effectively, or the processes that production uses to kind of track, you know, how to properly work with them to create estimates that are correct, and, you know, that kind of stuff. Like, you get all of that through experience, but there's a lot that you can do to kind of prepare yourself for that ahead of time. And the more you know about what someone else does and why they care about it, the better chances you're going to have making the right connections and going forward the right way.
That's an excellent question. If I might add, one thing is to not prematurely limit yourself in your education. You know, you have areas where you might identify a particular skill as a weakness, and so you might shy away from that. Don't do that. Don't shy away from that. You have an opportunity now to make some of these areas that are weaknesses parts of your strength, or at least you know, decent enough that you don't have to be afraid of these areas of skills. So that's an excellent question. Thank you. We had another one over here, down in the front. Or second row.
Hi, I'm Tina Miller. I'm in the game art program right now. This is kind of going back to talking about the expense of games. Since VR is starting to pick up a little bit more and there's more interest in it, do you think games are going to continue to be expensive?
I mean, if you add the peripherals and the type of computer you need, then yes, it can be. But remember, VR is not just the computer, it's also your mobile phone. And those are a lot of cheap experiences there, and a lot of them are actually even free. And right now on Steam, like, you know, we haven't really released any prices or seen any of the prices for Steam, but they don't look like a AAA, like, titles are coming out on Steam. They look like very indie, so expect them to be priced like indie. And until, like, the AAA devs make those AAA VR experiences, I think the prices will be very affordable, in fact.
Yeah, I'm still trying to wrap my head around VR. Like, I've as a AAA developer, literally, not
wrapped
around
your
head.
Yeah.
I think what I don't see anytime soon is making an experience that works in VR and also not in VR. Yeah. Right? Like, yeah. I feel like you're going to kind of focus on one or the other. So, I'm having a little trouble kind of seeing how it would, like, how that itself would impact costs. Like, I feel like they're kind of going to kind of be a different thing. So I'm not sure yet how it affects me. It's something I've only recently started thinking about and trying to figure out and kind of plan for.
While we're on the topic, Elbert, I wanted to mention, like, my body is ready for VR. I've been ready for VR for a while. Right. I think consumers, you know, for the most part, are ready for VR.
Yes, they are.
But for the most part, I've seen VR experiences being very kind of micro experiences, like as if VR is still trying to convince people that this is a good idea.
Right.
When are we going to see a shift away from, hey, we're trying to convince you this is a good idea, to larger experiences that, hey, this is tailor-made for VR, right, and this is a larger experience?
Like, there's a large demand for the headsets themselves, because right now it's a very constrained supply, mm-hmm. and a lot of the people who can create these experiences don't even have the headsets, even though they're big companies or really good, talented people. It's just not enough headsets right now. But I think come around April or later this year, when there are more headsets out there, then we'll start seeing more of this content. And also remember, a lot of these headsets have been only around for a year, year and a half, two, like, you know, the current headsets. And it takes time to make really good experiences. And, you know, as Jameson will tell you, like, a AAA game will take years.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're right now VR is in exactly the same space that mobile was in, which is people were, at the beginning of mobile, most people don't remember this, but I was working in touchscreen games before mobile, and so most people don't remember this kind of transition that we had into mobile, and that was that people were trying to just port experiences onto mobile and not designing the experience to be for mobile, and it was horrible. It was abysmal. I ended up doing a game design rant about this specifically because it's like, design your game for the device you're putting it on. So I would agree. I don't think we're gonna have a lot of transfer of, like, you know, you're not gonna play Assassin's Creed in VR and on your TV at the same time. There has to be a different experience there. But when it comes back to pricing as well, same thing as mobile, where the next probably year to year and a half, it's going to be these small, intimate little experiences. And then I think where you're actually going to start seeing the bigger stuff come is in the, you know, in the games like Gone Home or That Dragon Cancer, these indie games that are about, you know, some people call them walking simulators, whatever. But these experiences where you're just walking around a world and being part of the world, that'll be the first place that it kind of comes in, and that's when we'll see the price start to jump up to $20 from like a $5 experience of walking around the Vatican or something like that. And it'll start going up over time. And I'd say probably we're about 2 years from a AAA company. But at the same time, Eve Valkyrie is a VR game that's a AAA company. So
that's true.
Yeah. Does the adoption of VR devices, I mean, we're starting to go like mass consumer with some of these devices, but the prices on them kind of range a little bit, right? If you're on the Oculus side, I mean, some of these prices can be, you know, pretty steep, especially if you don't have a machine that's capable of running that. Gear VR is a little bit more, you know, accessible, but still, you know, you have a pretty restricted set of devices that it can run with, right? Like, you have to have a Note 5 if you want to run with the Gear VR. So if you don't have a Note 5, then that's an added cost to something that, you know, at the beginning seemed maybe a little bit more reasonable. Right. So, I mean, is the adoption just too difficult right now to kind of just pierce the market?
I don't think so. I mean, there's a lot of cardboard. It's a huge cardboard adoption rate right now. So I'm not sure if they released the numbers, but I'm not going to say it. But it's in millions.
For 90 cents.
For 90, yeah. For free, really. They don't really sell it. And it's coming, right? Because really right now we have two distinct sets of VR, right? High-end VR, the Rift and the Vive and cardboard and gear. And they're all going to converge in the middle, and we're just going to call it VR. There won't be any distinction. And the reason why the gear is so popular, because it's such a mobile device with a good enough experience that you can bring it with you. Here, try my VR experience. Okay, oh, that's awesome. Take it off and move on. So we're going to get there, and that's really, I believe, when VR is going to explode into mass consumption, because it's just so easy versus, you know, having a computer, cords, controller. Believe me, I love it. You know, I work with it every day, but there is a convenience factor in just putting on a headset and going.
I think the ultimate problem we have to get over is that everybody looks really silly. People don't like to look silly, right? That was part of why Google Glass died. If you use Google Glass, you're like, this is awesome. But I want this. But you look like an idiot.
The difference, though, is you can't look in a mirror and see
that
yourself.
Yeah, but as soon as you see a picture of yourself doing VR, and you're like, this is awesome. Like, as soon as you see that, you're like, I never want to do that again.
Yeah. That's not true.
Only in the privacy of my home.
Oh, yeah. Well, the thing is, you don't walk outside in VR, not like Google Glass. You're kind of walking.
Yeah, no, it's true. It's true. It's just right now everybody sees themselves doing it as a public demo, which is kind of scary. Yeah. So.
You know, I also want to touch back again on the bigger experiences part of that, because I want to caution, and I think people think they want bigger and longer experiences, but I want to point to things like Kinect and the Wii controllers, right? Like, you get to a certain point, for me, it's like 20 minutes where I'm like, I'm done moving. Like, I want to now sit down and do this again. Like, so I'm curious, like, how much people can kind of consume at once.
I can tell you.
Can you?
Yeah. We've done a lot of research on this. Basically, there's a novelty period of like 5 to 10 minutes of like, if you want to touch something, oh, I want to touch this button, this interface, yeah. And then everyone's going to be like, can I have a laser pointer so I can just do this? And basically, it's very quick. Mm. And you just need to make sure that when designing VR experiences, you design for more than the novel 10-minute introduction, but more for 8-hour, 20-hour, 40-hour use during a week. Mm. And be sure you know, be nice to your users.
Awesome. Do we have any other questions? The questions have been fantastic so far.
Yes. My name is Jason Panetta. I'm in game art. And since you've already mentioned that the microtransaction benefits smaller companies, I remember reading a review where it was mentioned that microtransactions could become something that even big game developers might adopt in the future, where I was thinking this over, pretty much would it become an issue in the future for game developers if they started adopting that method of making a game instead of just building the game and then selling it and then selling the download content? There they... forgive me.
That's all right.
This is actually was supposed to be two parts of the question. First one was microtransaction. Could it become a problem in the future for larger developers? And second, the use of beta testing as an aid for developers to work out the bugs and issues, would that be the solution to keep from falling into microtransactions for developers?
So I'm working on a game that is 24/7 in alpha microtransactions, and I work in a pretty big company. And having worked on AAA pay-to-play games, as I keep liking to call them, and this, I don't want to go back. This is a much better way to build games, because everyone can play my game. There's no barrier of entry. Like, you can have, if you have a PC or even a Mac, you can play my game for free, right? You don't have to pay to play. If you don't like it, if we can't hook you, all right, cool. Thanks for trying. But you didn't spend $60 and then go on a forum and be like, this game is horrible. I spent $60. I am so mad at them. People are just, you know, they either say we'll come back later or we won't come back. And the rise of beta testing is, so it's done for two reasons. Like, if you're like us, or World of Warplanes, or even early League of Legends, right? You have to most people forget, like, League was in alpha and beta for 2 years. What we're doing is we're trying to find the game that everybody wants to play. So we know the game that we want to play, we've built it, but we're iterating to find the game that we think everybody else really wants to play. And we're using the community to build that game. And so constant feedback from them, constant iteration. We're pushing new builds every few weeks. They're giving us feedback. We act on it, and we do something new. The other type of beta is just testing the systems, right? To make sure that the internet is not, like, when 1 million people come into our game, is our game going to crash? Are our servers going to overload? That's a different type of testing. But I think microtrans is trying to be figured out by big companies, and they don't want to go free to play. And so what they're trying to do is they're trying to put microtrans into their game. So I don't know who played Assassin's Creed Unity when it first came out, but they had microtransactions all throughout that game, and people revolted. And understandably so. You spend $60 on a game, why are you going to pay $1 for an XP boost in a single-player game? It doesn't make a lot of sense. So what we're seeing now is the AAA developers who haven't been making free-to-play games are learning from the people who have done free-to-play right. So, you know, you look at League of Legends, or you look at the Wargaming guys. They're doing free-to-play right. They're making lots of money. They're affording their, you know, they can afford to make new games, but they're not doing it in a way that makes people angry. And that's what we're trying to do as AAA developers that are doing microtrans and free-to-play is, I want to do something that allows you to get into my game with no barrier of entry, and if you like it, spend money on it. If you don't like it, okay. Or you can be like me. I play free-to-play games all the time, and I don't ever buy anything. I played World of Warplanes from alpha all the way through open beta. So I played for 2 years off and on, and I spent $5.
But you didn't spend any money.
I spent $5 when it went live because I was like, I played your game for 2 years. Here's $5.
How nice of you.
And I actually just gave it. I actually just gave it to somebody I knew. Yeah, it's just, here's $5. Thank you for your game.
You saw a similar, a bit of resentment from consumers with Diablo 3 when that came out with their auction house. So I agree that, you know, it's still an issue that, you know, people are trying to work through and figure out what works and what doesn't. Did that answer your question? Awesome. Did we have a question in the back?
Hello, my name is James Kim. I'm in creative writing right now. Well, I know there's a difference between AR and VR. So what form will be more pull out interest from the people if you're making a game with those two platforms?
So augmented reality versus virtual reality, like which one do you think is going to be adopted more?
Well, I'm working on VR.
Yeah, more sell the games on the different forms. So yeah.
Okay. So I think currently with the technology we have, VR will offer a more immersive experience, and that's what consumers are asking for. And AR has its own different usage, mostly for business use, or if you're a mechanic, you're looking at an engine, you want to see the real engine and overlay over it, then that works really well. Like, you know, not Minority Report, that's like the worst
UI. It's the dream.
Or, you know, HoloLens.
It is horrible UI.
Yeah, HoloLens has some pretty good use cases for it, like the Minecraft table and all that stuff. And they're two very distinct experiences, so I think they'll be fine both, but I think right now it's VR's time. AR will come as well, because, you know, as computers get smaller, faster, and really that's the problem with AR right now is machine vision, right? How does the computer know how the world is, and does it know the same context as you? We don't have that kind of machine vision right now, but it will come.
Awesome, thank you.
We have a question, a couple of questions actually from our online audience. The first is from Joe Rosselli with Game Design. He asks, which UX tools or techniques are the most effective in the industry today, and how can a future UX designer prepare to use them?
You're gonna look at me, aren't you? as far as tools, if we're talking about UX design from like a UI standpoint, in anything, Photoshop, anything that can show flow, ActionScript, just building prototypes in an engine for showing flow. For UX, the best tools are bringing people in, playing the game, watching the people, analyzing what they say, analyzing what they do. You know, having eye tracking. You know, we have like eye tracking, palm detection, sweat detection, perspiration, like all this crazy stuff. They're scientists. I'm a computer scientist, not a scientist. You know, they're doing all this crazy stuff. So really the value is, the most valuable thing you can do is bring people in and watch their reactions, have a survey that they fill out and explain how they feel about certain parts. I can tell you the most value that I get out of UX is sitting down and watching someone suffer through my game. yeah. It's horrible. It's one of my least favorite things to do, because you're just like, how dumb is this person? But they're not dumb, right? You see the game like this for years, and it makes perfect sense. Like, of course you have to hit escape and tilde and right click at the same time to do this move. Why would you not have to do that? But it doesn't make sense to somebody. So bringing people in is the most valuable thing. As far as tools, there's a lot of interesting tools for designers out there. I can't list all of them off because it would take a while, but I hope that answers the question.
Okay, I see a number of questions around. The first one that I noticed was over here. Then you have a question over here as well. So I'd like to start with those two, and then we'll come over here to you. Oh. Sorry, okay, I guess we'll start there, and then we'll come back down to you.
Yeah, sorry. Hi, my name is Legano. I'm in game development. My question is pertaining to the design process. Does the wall between casual and hardcore gamers really exist? And if it does, how does it affect you?
No.
No.
It doesn't exist.
Hardcore moms, man.
It doesn't exist at all. How many people in here play AAA first person shooters? Okay, keep your hands up. How many of you play games on your phone? There's no wall.
Now that doesn't mean there's not very different like design philosophies.
That's
and, you
true.
Know, ways to approach it and all that kind of stuff.
No.
But it's the same people, yeah. Right? It's absolutely.
I mean, it's not always the same people. There's definitely like a target audience that prefers casual games and will not, for any reason,
well,
go
we,
over.
That's we true the other way.
Bejeweled
right?
Not being a hardcore game, but it is a hardcore game because everyone plays it for hundreds of hours. A lot of people do.
It's true. My mom has played more hours of Solitaire than I have of any video game on the planet.
That's a hardcore game. Perfect.
Yeah, it really does. What do you call hardcore, right?
Yeah.
Like, I think time invested is probably the number one factor.
Right? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think what was, to kind of go to your point, though, you were talking earlier, I think, everyone who makes a game has a target demographic. You know, there's a bunch of studies out there where people talk about core Kyle and all these different things. There's different demographics that people tend to go towards. But what's crazy is you go for a demographic and then it shifts under you, right? So who knew that Minecraft would be the most popular game ever for like 8 to 12-year-olds, right? Like you walk by like any grocery store and there's like a kid in like a Minecraft shirt running around. And you're just like, what? I know Notch didn't know that when he made that game. So it's an interesting question because no, there's no gap or wall, but it does. But we do design differently for the types of games, right? There is a difference in design. There's different types of hooks. But what's really interesting is I think even big AAA hardcore games have the same hooks as Candy Crush. Like we take the same dailies and the same types of quests and the same types of iteration.
Yep.
Awesome. So down here we had a question. Second row. Individual with a fantastic beard and colorful hair.
How you doing? My name's Mike. I'm in computer animation. It's a two-part question. One is, I know VR is coming, but besides that, what do you see in the next 5 years, and how can we, everybody involved in the process of the game making, be prepared for it? What can we do?
Oh.
Buy life insurance.
I wish I knew the answer to a five-year question.
Right. Yeah, I mean, like, I don't see much past VR right now. Like, that's... I don't know.
I mean, that's how we talked earlier about how different things were from renderware to how they are now with middleware. Right. I mean, just seeing 5 years down the road is very difficult.
Yeah, like 1 year is a long time. Like
yeah.
In technology, it's
eternity.
We're almost certainly talking a new console within 5 years.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, that's true.
Have any of you used the HoloLens?
No.
I know it's pretty guarded by Microsoft, but
it looks sweet.
I think that from an AR perspective, in 5 years we might be there. We might solve the problems that you're talking about. But I think AR is going to be more of a cultural, it's just an acceptance thing. It's just going to exist everywhere, and it's just going to be part of our lives. Whereas VR experiences will hopefully have evolved past the "I look really goofy" stage to, you know, just a little set of glasses or something we put on, and some gloves, and then we're on, you know.
There was another part to that question, which is what can they do to prepare for themselves for VR or AR? Is there anything specific?
Keep learning. I mean, there's always going to be some new technology or new technique to use. Mm-hmm. And same for all of us here. I mean, we have to learn something new every week, every day. So just keep learning.
Animation is going to be really interesting in VR, though, because people are going to get real close. It's all art is going to be really interesting in VR because, you know, we're normally looking at it here and then depth. Now it's going to be right here, and I'm going to be able to walk up to your creature that's animating and be like, that's not how I would animate that, or right, like, have you ever seen a quadruped before? That's not how they walk. And I think everything is going to be under a lot of scrutiny in 5 years because we're going to be seeing AAA games doing VR, and I think that's where cost is going to have to go up.
Yeah.
And the thing is, it's hard to say like what to do and what not to do because VR is so new. It's like we're barely just cresting over to see how big that mountain is, or is there even a mountain there? It's just endless ocean. So
yes. Both.
Both.
Mountain with an ocean.
Yes.
In it.
Yes. but yeah, it's like explore it because like I tell every student here like VR. No one knows really how to do VR. I mean, I might think I know a little bit better, but not really. I mean, I'm learning about how stupid my ideas were from like a few weeks ago. I'm like, oh, why did I do that? And think that was awesome. And that's for everyone, right? So this is the time, this is like the opportunity, like the cell phones, right? If we knew back then that app development was gonna explode and make people millionaires, $30,000 sales in a day for a single person, you know, this is that time. And now everyone knows it's going to be similar to that, and we need, that's how you can prepare for it. Like, have the right skill set to be the person that will be, if someone needs, I need an animator for VR, which doesn't really make sense because you just use normal animations. But be
right
there.
Right now.
Yeah, right
maybe
now.
Maybe in 5 years.
Maybe in 5 years, might be different.
Over here, we had a question right by the camera. Questions, by the way, have been fantastic. Thank you guys so much.
First, I would like to say I'm a big fan of StarCraft because it's the first game I ever played.
Nice.
Awesome.
On that note, I'd like to ask, what is something you think works well for or would be a good idea for an RTS game?
What do you mean? Like, that's pretty broad.
Like design an unicorn. RTS right now.
Teddy bears and unicorns.
Teddy bears and unicorns, I'm in. You made a game with a unicorn in it.
Yeah.
I did make a game with a unicorn.
That was pretty legit.
Shot rainbows out of
Shot rainbows. That was so cool.
Jameson, how about you answer that?
Oh, man. I'm not much of an RTS player. So I guess what I would look for is something to appeal to me a little better. Man, what would that be?
I mean, I got one. I'm not even a panelist, but I got it.
Get in there.
So for me, honestly, I used to play Age of Empires 2 a lot, right? And I used to play it competitively. And one of the things that really drew me to AoE 2 was there was people that loved to play a random map, which was, you know, you start at the very beginning of nothing. And you take forever to get to the actual action. I used to play Deathmatch, which is you start with all the resources, you start at the highest age, and it's just go. And that got me into the action a lot faster. And I know that competitively a lot of people like to start at the very beginning and, you know, set up everything. But personally, I like to get to the battles. And the battles have plenty of strategy in there. So for future RTSs, I just wish that companies would facilitate getting into the action faster. So that's my wish.
Like Total War kind of game?
Yeah.
Exactly.
There you go.
Yeah.
I have it for you.
I know, right? Yeah.
You made your game. Yeah, no. Well done. I jokingly designed an RTS once where you played a tree. That was pretty cool.
Oh. Actually, I did design an RTS. Actually, I designed an RTS for a final project. Biggest mistake of my life. Because I didn't know what I was doing. And I did actually just do a physics-based RTS on Steam, which released this January. And that was actually a pretty painful process. But it was fun because it was like physics and RTS things that you don't mix because you have to be crazy to do that. But somehow we did it.
I kickstarted that game.
You did? Yeah. Yeah. You're one of my friends that played this game.
Yeah.
All right. We got a question down here, second row. And then the next one I saw was up there. So we'll go here and then up there. If my runner, I see you.
I feel like we should tell jokes during the mic transition.
I'm just making you exercise.
All right, who am I running to? Yeah.
No, right over here. In the front.
I should have a...
Second row.
Second row.
There you go.
Excuse me?
Second. Oh, you like ran all the way down the end. Should have a list of jokes, huh?
Yeah.
Thank you.
In a world. Hello, I'm Jamil Knight. I'm in game development. And Grant, you were talking about earlier how users would go, like, you know, why wouldn't you do it this way, you know? How do you get, like, as in terms of player feedback, how do you get players to understand something, you know, like, you know, get it? Because, you know, some people, like, for an RTS, it'd be harder to get players to know, like, all the rules and everything.
Yeah.
But for other games, it'd be simpler. So how do you go about
So it's all about having a good onboarding experience, a tutorial of some kind or something like that. Shiny, make things shiny. People like shiny things. They click on shiny things. You know, I can tell you many games that I've worked on that I've been almost in tears because people aren't noticing something. And it's like that is the key to the game. Like I designed a game called Jackpot Corner that's based on a Japanese style of slot machines. And what you do is you kind of are matching the corners of objects and then they disappear, and if you do enough you get coins and then you can pull the lever just like a, you know, like a slot machine. Well, no one noticed the lever, so we did a first round of UX tests, nobody noticed the lever. Next round of UX tests, we put sparklies on it, nobody noticed the lever. And if you didn't use the lever, the game was not that good. It was the core to making the game exciting. That was the wah moment, right? And so what we ended up doing is, like, the lever wasn't there, and then once you got enough, the lever popped up, and we had a little dialogue that was like, press the lever, and the lever was like, blah, 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 and you couldn't do anything but press the lever. And you did that once, and you saw how cool it was, and then all you were doing the rest of the game is you're looking for the lever to pop up. You're like, did I get enough? Is the lever there, right? And so it's really about introducing the elements that make your game great as early as possible, and making sure that they're learned in order, right? There's a reason every game that comes out has the same tutorial. Look left, look right, walk forward, right? Because I don't know your experience level when you buy my game, right? And the worst thing that could happen is me assuming that you've played every Assassin's Creed game and you just bought this new one and you've never played one and it's like, go do free running. And you're like, there's 22 buttons on this controller. How do I free run, right? So yeah, it's all about having a good kind of onboarding experience.
And I have one more question. This is just kind of open. When you guys, if you've developed like boss fights, how do you find a great cadence for that battle? Because is it like the music, or how do you like start?
How do you find what for it?
A cadence for like boss fights.
Cadence.
Yeah. How do you find like a decent one that goes well with what you've
That's an interesting question. I think first of all there's some kind of some basic rules to use, right? And I think some really good examples of kind of basic boss fight examples are the Mario bosses, right? When you've got like your three stages, players understand kind of the three acts, right? And understanding like, you know, I've got this thing that I'm going to do. It teaches me kind of the encounter with this guy. It's very easy to kind of take care of the first stage of this. There's a transition period where you understand that now the game has changed. Now there's going to be something different here. You have to quickly teach what that difference is. And then now kind of turn it up a notch, and so now there's a new element that's introduced, right? Give them enough time to kind of understand what's happening there. Allow them to then probably 50% increase in the difficulty of what you're doing before to take care of that next bit, and then you turn it up again. And now this is where it can get difficult, right? Because the last stage of that is the most difficult stage, but it's also probably the stage you want to be the shortest, because you don't want to frustrate people. And that's where the balance comes in, because when you create this stage, you also want them to experience it longer. That seems to make sense. But there's a delicate balance there of like creating a difficult experience that they've learned about while not frustrating them. So.
And then question from social media.
Yep.
This question is from Keith. Keith would like to know, what would you all recommend someone do to help keep up with the increasing speed of technological evolution?
Jameson?
I would say, like, read and talk a lot. Like, there's lots of information out there. I am not a research-type person. So, like, while I encourage people to do such things, I would rather someone tell me what's out there and what's
so, summarize in a tweet.
Right? I actually get most of my news from Twitter. So, but, yeah, I think conversations go a long way, right? Like, and I learn by interacting with people. Yeah. So that's if I can have a conversation. So, hey, did you hear about this? No, what is that? And then, you know, a 5-minute conversation, and I at least get the gist of something. I can then go and find out about it. But everything's changing so much, right? Like, you have to attempt to stay in the loop with what's coming up, and there's plenty of resources for that out there.
So to follow up on that, is there a difference between learning for learning's sake and learning for a purpose?
There is a difference.
You're assigned a task and you don't know how to complete it, right? Mm-hmm. That's the time you need to know that information. That's the time you need to learn.
Right.
Is there a difference between doing that and what, you know, sometimes I feel like a student might get this idea that they have to prepare everything before they even step in the door.
Right.
Yeah.
Is there a difference between learning for learning's sake and learning for purpose?
I think learning for learning's sake, what happens with that is you end up having it when you didn't know you were going to need it, right? So, yeah. So like if you're just kind of you're building your knowledge and your experience, and as you're kind of developing something, ideas will come up that, you know, you just wouldn't have had if you had not developed this knowledge. Learning because you specifically need to learn to do something probably means you're not going to learn the best way to do it, or you're just going to learn the way that someone else knows how to tell you or to instruct you to do,
right,
instead of you kind of evolving it and figuring it out the best way.
Okay. So we've got a question. I'm sorry, did you want to add
anything? No, I was just going to say learning for learning's sake is really interesting, because what it ends up being is that you just have a lot of, you have a broad depth of random things. Like, I'm interested in weird, just random things that have nothing to do with my job, like psychology and like city planning and like weird things like that. But ultimately, it ends up being something that you could use at any moment, right?
Those are literally two things for my job.
For your job, but not for my job, right? Like, that's not, like, what, I don't need city planning, but, like, you know, you never know, right? Maybe I transition into Jameson's job, you know, and now I have that knowledge. So
shots fired.
You could.
So we do have a question over here. I promise I haven't forgotten about you back there and the person in front, but we'll start over here.
My name is Cheryl Smith. I'm in the game design program. So unlike a lot of the people that I'm here with, my ultimate goal is not to go to AAA. So what suggestions do you have so that we don't get swallowed up in the massive indie scene that's going on right now?
So what do you want to do?
Eventually run my own studio, but I don't think I'm quite there yet.
But you don't want to do AAA, so do you want to do like experiential or casual?
I wouldn't turn a AAA job down if I was offered one, because it'd be a great experience just to have.
Yeah.
But I don't want that kind of corporate lifestyle. Yeah. I want something small.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. I mean, I would say there's so many options out there. There's so many
so
studios.
If we're designing games ourselves, like trying to just get out there mm-hmm. and get noticed, how do we do that without getting swallowed up with all the hundreds of thousands of indies that are coming out?
Make a really good, nice mechanic or a good hook for your game. I mean, and a lot of indies, like, you need like 5-10 seconds to hook someone.
Yep.
Hey, that's an interesting mechanic. This is why you should check out and try this game. And I'm really happy that you actually said that you don't want to work in AAA. It's not like I hate AAA. I love AAA. But a lot of people are missing the point of like being an entrepreneur and being an indie is a very valid and a very good complement to AAA studio work. And it's something that we need to do more and try to do more, especially when we're young. We don't have a lot of responsibilities, or maybe you do. But it is an avenue that will becomes like a passion for you, right? And
yeah.
That's really why we're here, because we're passionate about games. And that would be the closest to the of your own personal passion that you can work on and will make you the happiest, I believe, in my heart. And that's why I love being an indie. When I'm an indie, is being able to work on what I want and owning every single mistake and success and being able to go like, yes, I've learned from those and I will grow and be better.
Yeah. Michael, who was here last year, I don't know if anybody saw him last year. He graduated from Full Sail and just was like, I'm going to start my own company. And he just started making games, and he made his first game, and it was successful. And he just finished his second game, and he's like part of Indiecade, and like he was showing his game off at GDC last year, and he's formed a 3-man studio. He just went for it, you know. He was like, he looked at it, and he said, "I don't want to do." I mean, he even straight up said this to me. He said, "I don't want to do what you do. I don't want to work where you work. I don't want to be part of it. I want to just make games the way I want to make games with the people I want to make games with." And it's risky, but the rewards that you're gonna get. Like personally, not necessarily monetarily, are going to be better for that, you know. And if you don't want to start one right out of school, there's so many places, there's so many new startups, so many smaller studios, smaller teams. There's just a lot of places to work now. I mean, there's probably, I would say, 2 to 3 times more game developers now than when I graduated 8 years ago.
Yeah, yeah, that's a really important point, right? Like. We've been talking about the extremes, right? Like the AAA or the starting your own thing. There's a ton of mid-range small companies out there where you can have the level of ownership over stuff, and you're going to have to wear a lot of hats, right?
Yeah.
Because they need you to be able to do a lot of things, and there's a lot of fulfillment in that, and that's closer to be kind of preparing you for doing something on your own. But it's somewhere where you can kind of get in and learn, and you know, better prepare yourself to do that, and even like be doing it as you are getting your thing ready.
I mean, not that I'm hating on it. It's like,
you are.
No, I'm not. I work for a bank corporation.
like you work for the biggest company of the three of us.
Well, what I'm saying is like, I learned a lot when I work at Microsoft, right? How they run business, how executives do it, and how the processes work. And I take that information and apply that to my own indie games and how I run my business and all that stuff. So there is a lot of crossover that you will learn from being an indie, applying to corporate, and corporate applying to indie. And it's pretty cool.
And I would say in Final Project, don't try and mimic somebody. Just do something great. I mean, I made a casual game in Final Project, and everybody in our studio made fun of us because they're like, you guys are making a casual game. Yeah, but when we rolled up with our first milestone with a fully playable game that looked awesome already, they were like, oh, maybe we should have gone for a casual game. And you know what? Like that's still, I mean, probably in the top 10 of my favorite games I've ever made. It's cool. It's an interesting mechanic, and it was easy for us to make, and it was awesome to show to people. Like, I was so proud to show that game to people because it wasn't a tech demo. It wasn't a demo. It was, we had 32 levels in our game. It was a fully playable casual puzzle game.
All right.
Awesome.
We have a question over here.
Where are you? Oh, yeah. Okay.
Hi. My name is Joanna, and I'm in the Creative Writing for Entertainment program. I've read a lot of articles online about how story in a game isn't as important as like the technical aspects, and I was wondering what your guys' take was on that.
Well, we have a 5-person dedicated writing team on our projects, and I think, man, it's the endless debate about whether a game needs a story or the game is the story. And personally, I think that a story that is well woven into what you're creating is the most impactful experience, right? Like, when the problem comes whenever when they are created somewhat separately and you're trying to kind of figure out the ways to meld them together. Like, I've had experiences where we would design out a level and we would, you know, pace it out for the combat and for the gameplay and the stuff that we wanted. And then we would try and kind of interject the story into there. And we would literally, like, try and write stuff to fit in there. Like, oh, we don't, like, we want to tell this story bit here, but it's, like, 8 seconds long. And I'm like, the player only has 2 seconds here. Like, then it's, like, you have to kind of do it together. And it has, and we've integrated in, and writers are the partner in every aspect of our game so that we can get that meld and make sure that, like, that experience is cohesive.
Yeah, I worked on the narrative team, both on the game I'm working on now and on Doom. And the difference in how narrative was and how it became as we developed as a team is a lot better. How many people, on the narrative side, how many people have played Portal or Portal 2? Okay, how many of you played Doom 1, the very first Doom? Okay, I don't know if you know, but the story for Portal was inspired by Doom. So the way that the story is told in Portal is the same way that the story is told in Doom 1. Most people don't realize this, but they tell 90% of the story in Portal is told through environmental objects. And E1M1, the first mission of Doom, you walk in and you see a dead Marine and you see a shotgun and you see an alien corpse. And right there you know that these aliens, demons, whatever they are here to kill things. And that's the basics of the story. And you learn more as you go through the level. And that's more the narrative design stuff that you're talking about, as opposed to just feeding story straight into your face through, like, cutscenes and stuff. And I think we're seeing a lot of, you know, coming back to talking about games like Gone Home and Firewatch and, you know, games like that. They're 99% story. You are walking around like, oh, here's a water bottle. Oh, this water bottle was Timmy's, blah, 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 right? You're not doing a lot of game mechanics. You're literally just walking around discovering a story. You're part of an interactive piece of fiction. So I think we're seeing a lot of those come out. There's probably been 15 or 20 really good ones in the last 2 to 3 years that have been commercial successes.
Right, and VR is actually going to be the frontier for that. Because, you know, right now, everyone thinks, oh, we're going to put film in VR, 360 video, that's awesome. But it's not as nicely tailored for it. It will be interactive experiences, very much like Firewatch, where you kind of walk, you walk through the world and you become a participant in it. You're not just someone who's watching from afar from a screen. You're in it. You're living it. And it will be more natural to you. Like, yeah, it's like how you walk through, you know, hallway in Full Sail. You form your own narrative as you see people you know, like the smells and all that stuff. That's a narrative. I mean, I'm not saying...
Smell VR. It's coming, people. Prepare your noses. Yes.
But yes, it's narrative is interwoven to every single game. There's a narrative from a tutorial to your high score screen. That's all narrative, right? You start, press the start button, you play the game, you end with a, you know, high score screen. That's a narrative for most people.
Okay, awesome. We have time for just maybe like one or two more questions. I know, did you have somebody in mind?
Yeah.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Chris Patterson. I'm a computer animation student. I was wondering, you know, on the note of VR, how are we going to see user interface and learning curves for new games as they become more experiential and or maybe even more involved in terms of mechanics? How are we going to see that evolve? You know, I've seen some demos of like first-person shooter games that have been adapted to into the VR headsets. How are we going to see that? Yeah, how are we going to see that evolve in the next coming years?
It's actually going to be pretty similar to how we do things right now. You kind of have, especially with the more unintuitive types of gameplay mechanics, you do have to walk the person through. Like, we've learned that from a lot of our prototypes. Like, people won't know, like, you know, with the Vive controller, there's this grip button. Most people won't even know it's there because it's something where you put your finger. You don't really press here. The index finger, a lot of people will get because it's a trigger. You pull very easy. But the grip button, not so much. So if you're going to use more complex mechanics, you definitely have the tutorial. And that's for any experience, right? You got to teach the user how to do it so that they don't get frustrated and say it's a bad experience. Unless your goal is to frustrate the user and, you know, kind of like Surgeon Simulator, right? Like, figure it out.
Good luck.
Yeah, but it will be pretty challenging because I personally work on UX and UI a lot in VR, and it's a very upside down world compared to 2D screen UI development. So it's a lot of things to learn, and you know, for you guys to figure out and you know show and come back to Full Sail and share.
Awesome.
And we have our last question.
Jorge Castaneda, Game Development. I was just wondering how you guys feel about early access.
We failed. Oh, how we exited out or
no early yeah.
early
about
access.
Early
oh,
access.
Feel. Oh.
Yeah. How do you feel about early? How do you feel about like basically early access? We're paying full price for early access games, right?
Well, not
or not always full price, but sometimes like half price or something like that.
I mean, I have personal experience in working on an early access game. It's double edged, right? Because you kind of have to do a lot more builds to the public. It's already hard enough doing demo builds for shows, but doing for the public and making sure you have a complete game each milestone, even though it's incomplete, it's very hard.
Yes, it is. It's. I mean, our game's not Steam Early Access because you don't have to pay to get into it, but it is Early Access. For us, it's more about iterating with the community. And depending on what the game is, it's interesting. You are choosing to not only purchase, but you're choosing to invest in the future of the idea of a game. I don't really kickstart. I think your game was actually the last game I kickstarted. and it's because like that to me is very weird. I'm like, here, I hope you finish your product. Like, here's $20, right?
I finished the product, by the way.
So. Yeah, you did. You did, which is better than most of the people I've kickstarted. But you know, so you're choosing to go along with them on the journey of trying to develop this game. And if you think they're not going to succeed if they don't have $20 to buy beer or whatever, then that's fine. You're investing in the hope that the game will be better. But what I'm really wary at is that some people are going early access too early. They don't have a release process. So they don't know that they're going to release a build every 2 to 3 weeks, 4 weeks, whatever. They have no plan for early access. They just are like, I want money, so I'm just going to put this build up and then work on it for another year or two. Mm-hmm. So I'm very wary of it. If a game's free to play in early access, great, I'm in. I'm all for it. But if a game is not free in early access, I'm very wary of it, and I have to wait till people are like, hey, it's good, come on in, you know. And some games have been incredibly successful working that way.
Yeah, I mean, to go back to that, I mean, a lot of games right now, they don't get polished and really awesome until, like, you know, the very end. And with exposing the really ugly part of the game early on, you kind of, like, shortchanging yourself as a team. Or doing a big change. Like, a lot of times, like, you know, throughout development, you'd be like, oh, man, that mechanic really sucks, but that's a core mechanic, and we need to change it. And if you change it and people are used to the old mechanic, they can really hurt you in terms of reviews and all that stuff. So you kind of chain yourself to what you first released because that was a promise that was given to players. And if you back out of that, man, they will get mad at you.
Other than money, I'm not really sure what the point is. Like, I as a developer, like, I can get the kind of feedback that I would get from it through testing, right, and through, you know, that kind of stuff. So I guess, and as a player, I don't want to play something that's that rough. So I don't know. I have trouble seeing kind of what the real value is.
As a quick follow-up, I imagine that the feedback that you receive is overwhelming, both positive and negative. How do you filter out the message to target the things that are actually relevant that you want to like adopt and change in the game?
So we have like a full team that's dedicated. Part of our CS team is dedicated to taking the feedback and summarizing it in an easy way, and then finding basically already existing things that we have written up and saying, hey, you know, this is a hot issue because X number of people reported it. And then we look at the issues as they come in and we make a decision on it. Like, a lot of times for us, we kind of already have a plan. Before you as a player ever gives us feedback, we probably have noticed that you are suffering or you have a problem through analytics or just being able to watch what people are doing in the game. And so when we hear from you, we're like, okay, we already kind of have an idea of how we're going to fix this. It might take a while, though, and it's kind of hard to be really open communicative about, like, hey, thank you for submitting your feedback. It's a prize 3 compared to these 18 prize 0s. But, I mean, for the game that we're building, I can't imagine building it any other way than the way it is with Early Access. But, I mean, we've all worked on big products. I could not imagine doing early access for a AAA game because AAA games aren't there until about 2 to 3 months before ship. Yep. I mean, I remember with Rage, I remember with Wolfenstein. I mean, the first opening 15 minutes of Wolfenstein wasn't done until like 4 months before we shipped the game, right? It was like almost unplayable. It was gray box. And so I can't imagine, like, early access a AAA game, you're like, so the first level's done, and then it's all gray box. Tell us what you think.
Yeah.
Thanks for your 60.
Yeah.
All right. Well, unfortunately, that is all the time that we have. I wish I have so many more questions myself, and I know you guys have a lot of questions as well. And you guys have been absolutely fantastic. All of your questions have been on point. I really, really appreciate your engagement. And I really appreciate you spending your time with us here to talk about game design. So thank you all for being here. And please, please put a nice round of applause for our panelists here and sharing their thoughts. Thank you guys so much for being here.
I'm making dad jokes now.
Also, don't forget about that.